Okay. Why would somebody drive from North Carolina to the Comet Ping Pong Pizzeria in Washington, D.C. with an AR-15? I'm talking about Pizzagate. Did you guys hear about Pizzagate? It was the conspiracy theory now widely debunked during the 2016 election cycle, purporting that elite Democrats were gathering in the basement of the Comet Ping Pong Pizzeria and running a pedophilia ring while they were there. And this became so widespread that the owners were receiving death threats and people by the thousands reaching out and just basically electronically torching the place. And not just the owners, but the employees. And this just madness went on until December 4th, 2016. A young 28-year-old man shows up having believed this total conspiracy and with his AR-15 unleashed three bullets into the pizzeria. Fortunately, nobody was harmed. There was just some damage to the property. But this is symbolic of a harm that is caused by conspiracy theories such as this. Whether we're talking about Pizzagate or whether we're talking about the latest sort of manifestation of this, have you heard of QAnon before? Okay, and QAnon spreading disinformation all over the place. And it's causing a damage to the church of Jesus Christ that's every bit as real as those bullet holes in the Comet Ping Pong Pizzeria. They've done studies on this, and they've found that Christians are actually among the most gullible for conspiracy theories. That makes me sad, because it's really hard to convince people that on one hand, you have the truth, and on the other hand, you deeply believe that Hillary Clinton and Lady Gaga are eating babies. Now, you're like, I don't know if I can laugh at that. Eating babies bad, but okay. Nobody ate any babies, okay? That was the conspiracy theory, though. That was one of them. Now, I'm confident that none of you believed that one. At least I really hope that none of you believed that one. But can we at least agree? Probably all of us have fallen hook, line, and sinker for some article that was shared, some news that was put out there, only to discover that it had been later completely debunked. Has that ever happened to you? You're like, you got to check your sources on everything these days, don't you? It's like, it's so hard and increasingly harder to discern fake news, as they say, from true news. But as Christians, we must. Gullibility is not a spiritual gift. And how can we convince the world that we have the truth when we believe things that are obviously to most people lies? Well, we're in a series called Epic. It's in the book of Revelation. It's about the epic battle between good and evil and the shocking victory of the church. And when we talk about conspiracy theories and when we talk about the book of Revelation, it's interesting to me because the book of Revelation really is a conspiracy theory, not the world's, but God's conspiracy theory. It's a narrative that's meant to explain what's taking place in the world. It's a non-mainstream sort of alternative coded language, as conspiracy theories tend to be, narrative of what's taking place. In fact, the word revelation, it just means an unveiling. And it's meant to just give us this picture of God pulling back the curtain upon this world as we know it and giving us heaven's vantage point, which the rest of the world doesn't know about, but God does. And he talks to us about the deep state, and he talks to us about what he has done coming into history to deal with the deep state and how we can join in his victory. Yes, all of that is in Revelation, and you're going to see today. Revelation chapter 13, if you don't have your Bibles, the words will be up on the screen. Just to give you a little bit of context of what's happened just before in Revelation chapter 12, what we saw in chapter 12 was, whereas the primary figure in 13 is a beast, this is all symbolic language, in chapter 12, it's a dragon. And what we saw a couple of weeks ago is that Jesus came and he died on the cross and he rose again and he ascended to the right hand of the Father and he is crowned the ruler over the kings of the earth and the king of the universe, and he defeated the dragon who is the devil. And yet we saw that it was just a preliminary victory because the devil is still, quote, making war on God's people. And now we're going to see in this passage the means by which Satan makes war on God's people. So remember, this is all highly figurative. I'll explain the symbols. Okay, chapter 13. It says, "And I saw a beast rising out of the sea with 10 horns and 7 heads with 10 diadems on its horns and blasphemous names on its head. And the beast I saw was like a leopard. Its feet were like a bear's. Its mouth was like a lion's mouth." Now, this is a reference to Daniel 7. Make a little note. You can go back later. Daniel has 4 beasts, and the beasts share all the features of this singular sort of mutant beast that's a conglomeration of all these others. And the beasts in Daniel represent evil Antichrist empires, evil anti-God empires throughout history, Babylon, Greece, Rome, etc. And so this beast is sort of a mixture of them all. Let's keep reading. Verse 3. Actually, it looks like we're into verse 2. And to it, the dragon, who is Satan, gave his power and his throne and great authority. One of its heads seemed to have a mortal wound, but its mortal wound was healed. And the whole earth marveled as they followed the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, for he had given authority to the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast, and who can fight against it?" And the beast was given a mouth, uttering haughty and blasphemous words. And it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months, that 3.5 years we've kept seeing in Revelation. It opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. And it was allowed to make war on the saints and to conquer them. And authority was given it over every tribe and people and language and nation and all who dwell on the earth and worship it, everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb who was slain. That's Jesus. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to be taken captive, to captivity he goes. If anyone is to be slain with a sword, must he be slain. This is speaking of the martyrdom of God's people. The beast will make war upon God's people, and we will peacefully resist and be killed, it says. Here is a call for the endurance and the faith of the saints. Verse 11, "Then I saw another beast rising out of the earth. It had 2 horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence, and it makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose mortal wound was healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven and earth in front of people. And by the signs that it is allowed to work in the presence of the beast, it deceives those who dwell on the earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived. And it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain." So he's performing all kinds of miracles to be slain. Verse 16, "And it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark. That is the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of man. And his number is 666. Quick little story on 666. When I was in elementary school, each kid got a 3-digit library number. Guess what mine was? Every time I checked out the book, you know, the librarian would be like, "Ooh?" And I was like, "What's the problem?" She's like, "Unlucky number, huh?" I was like, "What are you talking about? It's so easy to memorize." I figured out later. But I just want you guys to know, your pastor does not have the mark of the beast. Just want to set that record straight. So diving into this a little bit, chapter 13, if I was to just kind of summarize this text in a single statement, which I like to do sometimes, it would be this: Satan is the real deep state, and Jesus is the real king. Satan is the real deep state, and Jesus is the real king. Now, why do I say that? Well, chapter 12 and chapter 13 are almost like perfect parallels of one another. In chapter 12, the very last verse of chapter 12, you see Satan, the dragon, and he's standing on the shore of the sea. And then where does the beast emerge from? The sea. And then you see Satan, the dragon, making war on God's saints. And how does Satan make war on God's saints? Chapter 13, verse 7, through the agency of the beast. And so these two are operating in tandem. In fact, both of them have seven heads and 10 horns. When we see the dragon, we see the beast. The two are one. And you say, that doesn't help me yet because I don't know what the beast is. What is the beast of the sea? There are two beasts. There's the beast that comes out of the sea. There's the beast that comes out of the earth. What is the beast of the sea? Something we have to understand, and this is just apocalyptic literature in general. We have poetic literature, we have narrative literature. This is apocalyptic, so it's full of symbolism, as I've been saying, but what can be confusing is that a lot of times the symbols can represent 2, 3, 4, even 5 different things at the same time. And so that is the case here. It symbolizes a few things, but I would put it like this: the beast of the sea is the Antichrist empire slash Antichrist. The Antichrist empire slash Antichrist. And I would really, yes, it says empires, and that's plural for a reason. it's plural for a reason, and that is that we talked about this last week. There will be a final manifestation at the end of history of evil in the form of an Antichrist empire, in the form of an Antichrist human being. All of that will happen at the end of time. You can watch that sermon, and you can go back and watch it. And yet this beast doesn't just represent the final manifestation, it represents all manifestations throughout history. In John's day, that Antichrist empire would have been Rome, ruled by Emperor Domitian, who required all of its residents to call him Lord and Christ. John wouldn't do it, so he's stuck on Patmos in political exile. Okay, so the Antichrist empires, whether we're talking about Rome, whether we're talking about the Ottoman Empire, whether we're talking about present-day Iran or North Korea, Satan is infiltrating every kind of government that he can. And he comes with this sort of Antichrist spirit, if you will. There will be a final manifestation, but this beast of the sea has existed for much longer than just the last 3.5 years of human history. And you say, but I want to know about that final 3.5 years because we all want to have our crystal ball, and I would love to tell you that the Antichrist is going to be, 6'3", he's going to have a mustache, he's going to, have this skin complexion, and he's going to, have that size shoe, and we'd all like to know all the details, wouldn't we? Well, I can't give you that much detail, but we can discern a few details. Okay, and so I'm going to give you maybe two of the most popular theories on this Antichrist empire and Antichrist that are out there right now, and then I'm going to kind of follow it up with a few nuanced changes that I'm going to make to these theories, and I'll explain why. So, first one is that this final Antichrist empire and king would be the Roman Empire and Caesar Nero. The Roman Empire and Caesar Nero. Now, Caesar Nero existed in history. He was the first imperial persecutor of the church, inflicted tons of fear upon the church. So we're talking about a guy who is famous for lighting his gardens with burning Christians. He killed Paul. He killed Peter. This was a really bad dude. And he died under suspicious circumstances in AD 68. I mean, it was suicide, but it was a little bit like, when someone famous dies today and it's under suspicious circumstances, we're like, is Tupac really dead? Is Elvis really dead? And people, these kind of rumors spread in the ancient world that happened with Nero. One ancient historian said most people believed he was still alive. And then it started to get with some people where they believe he would die and then, or that he really did die, but that he was coming back, and that when he came back, he would reclaim the empire. And in fact, this was even in John's day. I said, you know, Book of Revelation wasn't the only like apocalyptic book. There was tons of apocalyptic literature at that time. Well, some of the apocalyptic literature describes Nero is having like sort of come back from the dead and becoming the Antichrist, and it describes him as a great beast. And so one of the major theories today is they look at Revelation 13:3 that says that the beast suffered a mortal wound. That means it actually died. The beast died, but then it was healed. And in verse 14 says, came back to life. And so this was, you know, just like Jesus died and rose again, this is what you might call a counterfeit death and resurrection. And so one of the major schools of thought when it comes to this beast is that it's that it represents a sort of revived Roman Empire in the last days that will be led by a Nero-like figure over that empire in the last days, and he'll, you know, wreak havoc upon the church and so on. And so I think that this has merit when we look at the text and we just try to dissect its various parts. You know, people say, well, Caesar Nero, it equals 666 when you add up the numbers using this certain kind of tactic they used back in the day. And so I think a case can be made for that. But now let's look at the second theory, and I think a case can be made for this too. And this one's more recent. And usually I like to stick with older theories as much as possible, because when it comes to the Bible and theology, the Johnny-come-lately take is usually not the good one. Okay, good news is old news, right? And the old good news is that Jesus came, lived, died, rose again for us. I don't really need like somebody's latest take and new teaching. But when it comes to the end times, I do think there's some measure in which this will be sort of like revealed over time. It's revealed as we get there. I think 666 is one of those things. I don't think anybody knows for sure what it means, except that it falls short of seven, and six is the number of man, so it's kind of like 777 would have been God's perfect number. 666 is like everything Satan does just falls short. Okay, so it's something like that, but there's I think that some of this stuff that as we get closer to that time, it's going to start to unravel, and this might be that. The Ottoman Empire and the Mahdi. That's the second popular theory, and it's a little more recent, like I said. The Ottoman Empire, which was an Islamic empire, and the Mahdi. And you probably don't know what the Mahdi is, but think of him as like the king, ruler. He was in Islam, in Islam eschatology. They're sort of end times, what the Quran says. The Mahdi is the sort of end times final leader of the caliphate. Okay, and so we'll explain a little bit more about that. But what do they say specifically out of Revelation 13 to teach that the Ottoman Empire and the Mahdi is what Revelation 13 is about with this beast, that this great beast of the sea somehow represents that? Okay, a couple of things. First of all, Revelation 13:3. You remember a moment ago I was talking about how the mortal wound was healed on this beast? So a lot of people these days are pointing to that, and they're saying the Ottoman Empire is that beast of the sea, and it suffered a mortal wound in 1923. Sorry, I can't get my throat clear this morning. A mortal wound in 1923 when the Ottoman Empire died and was replaced by modern Turkey, a secular state. Before that, the Ottoman Empire ruled for 500 years, and at its height, it was massive. It was sprawling. I mean, parts of Europe and Asia, the Middle East and Africa. I mean, it was this massive empire, and it was an Islamic empire. And so they say, look, it died in 1923, but just like the head of that beast was healed, the Ottoman Empire is being revived today. And so have you seen, for instance, in the news, have you followed anything about Turkey and President Erdogan and some of his actions lately? Okay, so Turkey, you know, they've been secular since 1923, but he's now reversing that. In July of this month, he converted the biggest church in the world for 1,000 years, the Hagia Sophia, which is in Turkey, converted it to a mosque, covered the Christian artwork with black drapes. They held an Islamic service in there, and all of Turkey's sort of high brass officials were there. I watched a video of it. The guy, the imam, carried a sword to the pulpit, which was a historical and traditional symbol of conquest of Islam. And afterward, lest we don't know for sure what Erdogan's intentions were, afterward he gave a speech, and he talked about his aspirations for restoring the Ottoman Empire. And he said that one day we will take over the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. I listened to his speech. When you look at his actions today, Turkey is persecuting Christians. When put up to it, he refuses to denounce the Armenian genocide of 1.5 million Armenian Christians. Okay, that was in the early 20th century, but it was by the Ottomans. So he's refused to denounce that, and he's sending his military all over former Ottoman territories and actually attacking them and trying to seize territory. You can go back and look it up. I saw an article just this week. It was, and these articles are even coming back and like coming out in like what the Washington Post and secular Western newspapers. But this one article I saw, I thought its title was kind of funny. It was Erdogan is making the Ottoman Empire great again. Okay, so they'll point to that and they'll say, well, maybe this is that. So that's one. So here's the other thing they'll look at. They'll look not just at the mortal wound that was healed and say that's the Ottoman Empire. They'll also look at the way Islamic eschatology seems to match and be the inverse of Christian eschatology. So for us as Christians, we have two primary end times or end times figures right here. They're the bad guys. There's the beast and the false prophet, who is the beast of the earth. Later in Revelation, he's called the false prophet. So let's just call these the Antichrist and the false prophet. But when you get to Islam, they also have two figures, but our bad guys are their good guys. And so for them, it's the Mahdi. He's the leader of the civil side, of the political side, and his partner is, believe it or not, Jesus. Muslims actually believe in Jesus. They just don't believe he's the Son of God. They believe that Jesus is even coming back, but they don't believe he's coming back to rescue Christians. They believe he's coming back to kill Christians. They believe he'll come back and he'll perform signs and wonders and he'll get everybody to follow the Mahdi. And so you look at this theory and you can say, you know, that really does sound pretty similar. That really, and personally, I will tell you, I think it sounds feasible. But I also want to say this, even as we have this conversation, I think we have to say this in this day and age. I do think that, like, amongst a lot of Christians, there's an unnecessary fear of Muslim people, okay? Like as though your average Muslim is a terrorist or something. I've had Muslim friends, none of them were terrorists, and the vast majority of them, maybe 99.9%, are not terrorists. Most Muslims are extremely, extremely good, loving people. But I also have to say that I can love Muslims and hate Islam. I think Islam is a bad religion. It's actually an Antichrist religion. In the letters of 1 John, it says, anyone that denies that Jesus is the Son of God is an Antichrist. Islam denies that Jesus is the Son of God. And our culture would like us to all sing Kumbaya and have one giant, wonderful religion together. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to compromise on that. The Apostle Paul would not have gone on his missionary journeys all around the world if everyone's religion was the same. He goes into Athens and he sees all their idols, and it says he was provoked in spirit. When I see people bowing down in Islam, when they hear that prayer call, it provokes my spirit because I know, according to the Bible, they're worshiping a demon. They are. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 says, as well as Deuteronomy 32. Every god, except the one true God, is a demon. So I think we need some people to speak some real truth these days because people seem to be afraid to do that. And yet, we want to speak truth in a loving way that doesn't demonize people. Muslims are good people. They are, by and large. And there's some bad ones, and guess what? There's some bad Christians, too. So, all that to say, I do think that it, when you look at 2 billion people almost in the world today who are Muslim, and that Islam is the fastest growing world religion, and they're all having like 5 and 6 and 8 and 10 kids, and when you go to Western nations and they're having like 0 and 1, and it's just demographics and time, guys. And so I think that's a very feasible theory. But here's what I would also say. I would differ from both of these, the sort of Caesar and Roman Empire, as well as the Mahdi and the Ottoman Empire. I would differ from both of these in one major point. And it really has to do with how we understand this specific text and the work that Jesus came to do in his life, death, and resurrection. Because that's what I think the wounded head of the beast is really about. I don't think it's about a revived Ottoman Empire, although that might happen. I don't think it's about a revived Roman Empire or a Caesar Nero, or although I'm certain that when the Antichrist comes, he will be much like Nero. I don't think that the wounded head coming back to life is any of those things. I think that has actually already happened in history. It happened at the cross. I want to explain how we arrived there. You remember when I said Revelation 12 and 13 are in parallel? What do we see in chapter 12? We saw that through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, he now reigns over the kings of the earth, and we saw that he conquered the dragon. The dragon was cast down to the earth. But it was a preliminary victory because the dragon lives on, continuing to wreak havoc. We see the same thing in chapter 13. We see a beast that's wounded mortally. It actually dies. It's wounded mortally on its head. It suffers a death blow, and yet it continues to live on and to wreak havoc. And that word wound in Revelation 13:3, it's translated 11 times in Revelation as plague. We've studied a bit about plagues in this book, haven't we? They're issued from heaven. They're issued from a divine hand. This is the divine hand of God in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, stomping not just the dragon, but also the beast. Not just Satan, but also tyranny. And this aligns with the Old Testament understanding upon which Revelation 13 was written in the first place. Daniel chapter 7, there's like maybe 10 allusions to Daniel 7 and Revelation 13. And what we see is that in those four Antichrist empires, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome, what we see is that those four Antichrist empires, it prophesies in Daniel 7, 11 to 13, that when the Messiah comes, one like a son of man, it says, Jesus is our son of man. That when this Messiah comes, it says he will take dominion away from all of them. I think Christians sometimes are like, it doesn't look like Jesus reigns. Maybe one day he'll come back and reign. No, he reigns today. And when he came, he seized dominion from all the false antichrist evil empires. Daniel 7:11. But in Daniel 7:12, it says their life was prolonged for a season and a time. And then in Daniel 7:13, he comes back and finishes what he started. That's exactly what we saw right here. He defeated the beast just like he defeated the dragon. He conquered them. He stole the dominion from Satan and from the beast and all the Antichrist empires. And now Jesus presently reigns. And yet, prolonged for a season and a time are those Antichrist empires. So just as Jesus defeated Satan, he also defeated the beast. You say, well, why did he allow a season and a time? Why did he allow them to have this prolonged life? Why didn't he just kind of finish it all at the death, resurrection, and ascension? Aren't you kind of glad he didn't do it that way? Because if Jesus consummated his kingdom 2,000 years ago, would you be here? You wouldn't. 2 Peter 3, it says that he did this so that more, he had this long delay, and Peter says, people are going to be saying, yeah, the Lord's never coming back, never coming back, and he says the reason for this long delay is so that more and more and more people will repent and find eternal life in him. And I think all of this speaks to what's going on in America today. Because in America today, I look at us, I saw the debate on Tuesday night, it actually just grieved my spirit. It grieved my spirit because, I mean, I wouldn't allow my kids to. I'm just being honest with you guys. I told them, I said, you guys would be grounded if you acted that way. It made me sad. It was an embarrassment to the United States, but you know what? It was us. This is what our nation is right now. Watch, you know, on Twitter feed, hey, somebody punched somebody in the face. It's like Bucky's down the road. Somebody punched, you know, Trump supporter punched somebody else in the face, and it goes both ways. Everybody's punching everybody. Everybody's being mean to everybody. Everybody's hating everybody. And it's a picture of this deep, dark, moral and spiritual abyss that we are entering into. And I want you to know, listen, I think democracy is the best government that we can have in this life. I think it is, and I love America. And I say, God bless America. But you know what? Democracy won't save us. Only Jesus can save us, because Satan can infiltrate any government. You know, Hitler was voted for, okay? Satan can infiltrate any government. And so here's what I want to say. Like, listen, we need to vote. And this comes up like all the time, like over and over again. I believe God is emphasizing this to us. Like, I don't even have to be a prophet to say this. If America does not repent of her sins, where we're at right now is the best it will be, okay? Because it is judgment, and it gets worse and worse and worse. Because when Jesus is the king of the world and governments become Antichrist, that government just dies and dies and dies until it's dead, okay? The only thing that will save America is if America repents and turns to Jesus. If we don't, I'm 100% sure this is the best it gets. It gets worse from here. But if we repent, if America repents, and there are some signs and people are pointing out and millions of people, you know, getting, like I hear some like little signs of good things happening. If a critical mass of Americans repent and turn to Jesus, I feel 100% confident things will go the other way. They really will. And even if we don't get that critical mass, even if we don't, if you repent, if I repent, if those, just on an individual level, the Bible calls this the remnant. Anytime God visited judgment upon a nation throughout history, there was always the remnant that was taken care of. If there's a critical mass, God saves America and we enter into a golden age. If America doesn't repent, but you do, then he saves you from the worst of it. And so I am concerned about the downward spiral. And I'm telling you, this moral and spiritual abyss that we are entering into and have already, it's not going to change without repentance. America has to actually turn to God. And I hope that you do. And this is not just for afterlife considerations. In this life, your experience through all of this depends on your friendship with Jesus. Are you right with Jesus today? And so Jesus conquered the beast, and he conquered the dragon, he conquered Satan, and he conquered tyranny, and he allowed them to have a prolonged time so that more and more people will repent. But one day Jesus is coming back, and he is going to drain the swamp like nobody ever could. That's right. He really will. He really will. And it's going to be perfect, but it won't be perfect until then. So that's what our hope is in. That's what our hope is in. And when I think about John writing this letter and the Emperor Domitian, who has said, you're going to be exiled to an island because you won't call me Lord and Christ. And I picture John, instead of being just outraged, instead of just being hopeless and despairing like so many in our nation, I picture him writing these revelations down with total peace, because he knows who's on the throne. It's King Jesus. You say, so what do I do with this? Well, I've already told you one thing, and that's repent. that's turned to Jesus. That's Jesus' central message. He says it in Revelation 2 and 3 to the seven churches. Like, what do I do now? Repent. What do I do now? Repent. It's like people are like, how do I prepare for the return of Jesus? Do I you know, buy 10,000, you know, bags of grain? And do I, you know, dig a bunker 1,000 feet deep? And do I do all of these? I don't read any of that in here. I mean, I think it's good to be generally prepared, but repent. That's what you do. And if you repent, God will take care of you. And if you don't, you won't be taken care of. That's just the way it is. Okay, but I'll just give you a couple of practical things. Number one, I've already begun to touch on, and that is watch out for excessive political allegiance. Watch out for excessive political allegiance. Listen, we live in a two-party system. We're pretty much kind of forced to vote one way or another. I suppose you can go third party too, but I'm just saying we don't have just tons of options, but we do need to be concerned about political allegiance, because what we see in Revelation 13 is Satan infiltrating the power of the state, and he does this in monarchies, he does this in democracies. As I said earlier, Hitler was voted, and do you know who voted for him? You know whose support he relied upon the most? Protestant Christians. Quote from a Lutheran theologian. 1934, he said this the year after Hitler was elected. He said, "Our Protestant churches have welcomed the turning point of 1933 as a gift and miracle of God." So we have to watch out for excessive political allegiance. My allegiance is to Jesus, okay? We have to give Jesus our allegiance first of all. Is that going to play out in voting a certain way? It will. But that can't come first. Jesus must come first, or else we are vulnerable. I think that's a blight upon the church that happened. Okay? And am I calling one of our candidates Hitler? I'm not calling one of our candidates Hitler. I am simply saying we have to be careful. We all have to be careful. And we have to walk in discernment and not gullibility. And we have to walk in truth. Satan is a bipartisan deceiver. Number two. Watch out for counterfeits. Watch out for counterfeits. Okay, counterfeiting is a major theme of this section. We saw the counterfeit death and resurrection earlier. There are counterfeit miracles of the false prophet. There's even a counterfeit Trinity. We worship the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, but there's coming there already is, the dragon, Satan. Then there's the Antichrist and the false prophet. And so they actually, even when you look at their, like, the way they operate, it's very much the same. People worship both the beast and the dragon. Isn't that interesting? Okay, and so so we have to watch out for counterfeits. One of the counterfeits in this section is that famous mark of the beast. This is actually a counterfeit. And if you've been in Revelation before with us, if you've been to this series, you know that in Revelation chapter 7, there is the seal of the living God placed where? On the forehead. Anybody remember that? The seal of the living God placed on the forehead. So God is about to pour out his wrath, his judgments upon the nations and upon the people who refused to repent, who refused to receive him. But for those who did, for those who did repent, for those who walk with them, it says, cover the servants of God with the seal of the living God upon their forehead. Why the forehead? It's identification. If your identity is not in Jesus Christ, you will not be safe in this age or the age to come. You won't. Okay? You won't be safe. Our safety is in finding our identity in Jesus Christ. But the mark of the beast is really just a counterfeit of that. And both of them serve not just for identification, but for protection. The seal protects us from God's wrath, but it doesn't protect us from persecution. The mark of the beast protects us from persecution. You can buy and sell, you can live a happy, you know, life because you have your allegiance to the state and all of it. So the mark of the beast offers you protection from persecution, but it does not offer protection from God's wrath. So what would you rather be protected from, persecution or God's wrath? And so there's a counterfeit, and this mark of the beast is like, there is more conspiracy theory about the mark of the beast than anything. I mean, you know, it's a microchip that's going on the back of your hand or on the back or on your forehead. Here's what I gotta say. Maybe it is, but also, if I had to guess, the mark of the beast is probably not even physical. Because the seal of the living God isn't physical. Almost everybody agrees that that's spiritual. I mean, it says in Revelation 14 that the name of Jesus and of our Father is written on the forehead. Like, I don't even know if I have that much space on my forehead. Like, we're going to need to have receding hairlines in the age to come in order to have enough space for that. This is a spiritual seal. So I think it would be natural for us to understand the mark is spiritual. Now, since COVID happened, here's the latest one. The latest one, this is the latest conspiracy theory. I don't know if you've read this before, but I don't know if you knew that Bill Gates openly worships the devil, and he has a vaccine with the mark of the beast implanted inside. And if you get a COVID vaccine, Bill Gates will implant the mark of the beast, and your soul will be damned for eternity. That's the conspiracy theory, guys. Now, guys, that's ludicrous. It's not going to happen that way. You really think God's going to be like, wow, you know, Sheila, my faithful servant, loved me for all of her days, served me, washed the feet of the saints, cared for the poor, but she got that vaccine. I'm going to have to damn her. I'm sorry, I shouldn't even say that as a joke. I just didn't really kind of see that one ahead through. So, do you really think God's going to do that? He's not going to do that. You're not going to be duped into it because you got it. Now, here's the thing. I would be concerned about, like, I'm sorry. Like, mark of the beast aside, if I was a total pagan, Uncle Sam's not going to put a microchip in me. Sorry. Like, that's kind of a privacy thing, you know? I don't really want to be tracked like that. There are concerns. There are concerns about rushed COVID vaccines. Like, here, just take it quick. You know, like, I think we, you know, there are legitimate concerns. But the mark of the beast isn't going to happen that way. The mark of the beast is more about allegiance. It's about following Jesus or following the beast. It's about it's about a decision. Like, the best protection against the mark of the beast is not to figure out Bill Gates' secret plan to mark you for Satan in hell. The best way to avoid the mark of the beast is to pledge your allegiance to Jesus and to give him your entire life and your entire heart. And if you do that, you're actually safe from the mark of the beast. With the rest of that stuff, microchips and vaccines and all of that, just walk in wisdom. But that's not what the mark of the beast is. So I want to finish with one thought, and we'll just kind of tie this up, because as we're talking about conspiracy theories and coronavirus and all of this, I read just recently that ever since COVID hit, conspiracy theories have massively been on the rise. And specifically QAnon, I mentioned them earlier. They peddle in this a lot, but QAnon content on Twitter increased 71% since COVID, and on Facebook it increased 651%. This means people are believing it and they are sharing it. Stuff like Hillary Clinton eats babies, like that kind of stuff, is getting shared all over the place. But it honestly makes sense. Why it would happen during COVID. Why? Because whenever the world gets crazy, we look for a narrative that can come close to explaining the nonsense that we're living through, the madness of this world that we're living in. And that's precisely why God gave us apocalyptic literature. It's God's sort of coded language, his way of pulling back the curtain of him saying, guys, here's the real story. And our job, you're a conspiracy theorist now, okay? You're a conspiracy theorist. I am too. We believe the book of Revelation is true. We believe the conspiracy is true, namely, that even though it looks like evil is having its heyday, and even though it looks like evil has the upper hand, it may not look like it, but Jesus is still king. And he conquered the dragon, and he conquered the beast. And even though the dragon and the beast are getting their followers and will get their followers, the followers of the Lamb can see right through the propaganda, because if you're walking with Jesus, there's no mistaking a beast for a lamb. Let's pray.